The Coyote People, Legends and Stories by Laurel Marie Sobol. The Nez Perce, the Nimiipuu, Introduction. The Nez Perce are my heritage, a heritage that came about on a beautiful, warm, and perfect spring day in Weimar, Oregon, in the mid-1980s, 1987. Laurel was with her mama visiting a dear and beloved friend and his wife at their home on a quarter horse ranch. Ma was very eager to bring Laurel to meet her new friend, James Martin, and his wife, Lottie. Laurel had heard many nice things about them, and she was eager to meet them for herself. The day arrived when it was time for Laurel to meet James and... Lottie. Ma drove Laurel about 7 miles west down the highway to their modest ranch-style home, facing East Evans Creek Road. On the right, just before the tiny town of Weimar, was the sign that read J. Diamond L. Ranch. Ma turned right onto a one-lane dirt road, shaded over with old oak trees, with dappled sunshine filtering through the leaves and branches onto the road and house. And beyond a field was a river called East Evans Creek. Ma came to a stop right at the front door to the house. Ma and Laurel got out of the house car and went up to the front door and knocked on it. Laurel stood 3 inches taller than her ma, behind her about 3 feet, and waited for them to come to the door. They heard the sound of approaching footsteps and the door opened up, and then the screen door too. There stood James Martin, one of the great-great-grandsons of Chief Joseph. He stood at the top of several stairs and looked at them, and they looked at him as they stood transfixed for a moment in time, in a capsule, pure light, if you will. Magic was in the air, light and crisp, energetic and full, electrical. Laurel knew instantly that there was something different about this person who stood before her and Ma. He was beaming energy from an energy source seldom seen on Earth, a rare and pure energy of one working closely with God and a person of integrity and principle. Laurel had found a kindred spirit and she knew it immediately. Ma knew this too. Then James motioned for them to come in as he said, "Well, hello. Come in and sit down. How are you now?" Laurel and Ma did as they were bid, and they came into James and Lottie's home and sat down at the kitchen table near the shady side of the house. And they both smiled with joy at being in the presence of such fine, wonderful people as James, Martin, and Lottie. They knew what an honor it was to be here at this home with these two special people, and they. Thoroughly enjoyed every moment, not letting a microsecond go unappreciated or unvalued by either of them. The looks on their faces were sure to give them away. They could not possibly hide their joy at being here with James, for it was joy above joys to be here with him and his family today. Ma and James got to talking, and Lottie came in to visit, too. Time seemed to be gone from the planet, to have utterly vanished, as anything that was a tangible thing, a feeling to experience for Laurel. Laurel felt like she was in the middle of experiencing one of the best days of her life, and she knew it. And she was absorbing it to the fullest without missing anything at all, for she couldn't because it was all so wonderful and precious. Stories of past and present were shared this day, and time did move, but in a way that was not easy to explain. It moved in a way that brought James and Lottie, Ma and Laurel, and the circle of their families together in a united family union of adoption called Adoption of the Heart and Spirit. On this day, James swept Ma and Laurel into his family by adopting them into his life and his heart right there and then. There was a very formal moment in time during this period and a series of events, of things not tangible or describable with the written pen, but events that would forever bind the hearts and spirits of Laurel, Ma, James, and Lottie forever on this most incredible and eventful day. James was vibrant, lithe, energetic, timeless, and a great storyteller. These stories and legends have all been shared through the generations from one Grand Nimiipuu to the next, as each one tells stories one by one so the stories never get lost over time. And these were passed on by James Martin. They passed out a surrender. The years before that, when Lewis and Clark explored the land in 1804, the Nimiipuu, which meant the people, found the explorers starving to death, sick and lacking in clothes. Visiting coastal tribes with shell decorations and nose piercings were grouped together with the Nimiipuu and named Nez Perce by Lewis and Clark. The Nez Perce in the Columbian Plateau Gorge fed, doctored, and clothed the Lewis and Clark members before Chief Twisted Hair led the explorers down the Columbia River to the coast people. Lewis and Clark noted that the Nez Perce were the most religious and honest people they had ever encountered. They left all their equipment, horses, and supplies with the Nez Perce before heading to the coast with Chief Twisted Hair. The coastal natives led the Lewis and Clark expedition to what is now called Astoria. Lewis and Clark told the Nez Perce that thousands and thousands of white people would be coming across the continent and that there would be gold and land for everybody and that we can all live together like brothers. The Nez Perce promised Lewis and Clark that they wouldn't shed one drop of white man's blood. They kept their promise up until the declaration of war by the United States Army when it was forced upon them. Chief Joseph was only one chief of many chiefs, as each band had a leader ranging from 30 members to about 200 or so. Chief Joseph was considered by many Nez Perce to be peaceful, and he was respected by many chiefs and tribal members. He told his people to survive, they had to learn their ways to live with them. The wild chiefs wanted war, and the white people to leave their lands. Originally, the Nez Perce land stretched from the Columbia River south to the Powder River. The Powder River goes through Baker City and from the summit of the Blue Mountains to the Snake River, and that no white man was supposed to go in there because it was Nez Perce territory. White people kept coming into the Nez Perce territory anyway to find gold. They would tell people about the gold and more folks would come into the Nez Perce territory in search of gold, too. The white folks found many of the hidden meadows that were tucked away in little sheltered valleys where the Nez Perce wintered and kept their cattle and horses who all thrived there. When it was learned that the Nez Perce were sitting on valuable land with gold on it, the U.S. Army reduced their land by more than half of its original size. At first, the land was taken away from the Nez Perce. Then they would have to move to Lathaway in Idaho. and that they had only 30 days to make the move in winter when floodwaters raged. Chief Joseph went to ask General Howard for more time to move all the livestock, people, and housing. The wild chiefs wanted to drive out the whites, but Chief Joseph persuaded them to be peaceful. Chief Joseph talked his people into going east and not fighting. The Snake River was in full flood when the Nez Perce had to cross it with all their people. Not a single person died in the river crossing. The cattle and horses died in vast numbers, drowning as they tried to cross the river. For as far as the eye could see, horse and cattle bodies lined the river banks and rocks downriver. The Nez Perce loved their horses and cattle. They lost over 1,000 head of cattle and horses. The Nez Perce told Chief Joseph, "You are responsible for this because you wanted the Appaloosa breeding program. Now look what you have done." In 100 years or so, the Nez Perce had created the Appaloosa horse. No other people had achieved this breeding success in so short a time period. The sight of the livestock, dead and dying downriver, overwhelmed the Nez Perce. All the chiefs said, "See, look what you did. You did this. See what you've done. We'll never follow you again." So Chief Joseph went back to see General Howard and request additional time to move everyone and their belongings to Lathway, Idaho. General Howard once more said, "You have 30 days and no more." While Chief Joseph was away asking General Howard for more time to move to Idaho, a Nez Perce elder man had decided to go hunting for buffalo just one more time before he was too old to hunt again. This was Red Moccasin Top's father. This man was young Red Moccasin Top's father, a man who had taken up white man ways and made himself a cabin in the valley. Red Moccasin Top's had taught a white fellow the Nez Perce ways and had befriended Red Moccasin Top's father. Red Moccasin Top's dad returned to his house to find the white man had moved into it, and the white man told him, "You left your home and gave it to me. It's mine now." Red Moccasin Top's father replied, "Nope, I asked you to look after my place and to take care of it for me. You know, I never gave this place to you." Red Moccasin Top's dad told the white man to leave. The white man shot him in the stomach. He crawled off and died. The old man said, "I asked you to take care of my place while I went hunting for buffalo. This is my home, not yours." The white man shot Red Moccasin Top's father in his stomach and he crawled off and died. Red Moccasin Top wanted to avenge his father's death. He went to get some young fellers who slipped away to Red Moccasin Top's father's home. They found two white folks living there that weren't the ones who killed his father. Red Moccasin Top and the young fellers killed the two white guys and found a keg of whiskey. They got to drinking whiskey and went back to their camp to get more fellows to help avenge the death of Red Moccasin. Dad. They went and killed seven white folks they had found. Chief Joseph had just returned from his visit to General Howard with no success of more time for his people to move to Idaho. He learned about the death of Red Moccasin Top's father and the people that had been killed as a result. General Howard of the U.S. Army moved on the Nez Perce upon learning of the white folks' deaths the next day. That's what started a long battle. Some say that had the Nez Perce warriors given themselves up to the U.S. Army that the battle would have been averted, but they didn't, and war ensued. General Howard attacked the Nez Perce. The promise made to Lewis and Clark was no more. At the end of the war, Chief White Bird and his band of Nez Perce people were sent to Kansas, while Chief Joseph and his band of 411 people were sent to Oklahoma via the Missouri River on flatbed boats and then by railroad cars. In less than 7 years, the bad water, air, and disease took their toll on the Nez Perce, and only about 200 people survived. Then they were taken to Washington and put on the Powell Indian Reservation, where they remained. Chief Joseph died there in 1904, and his grandson was raised and lived there up until he was in the fifth grade. James Martin was one of Chief Joseph's grandchildren. He is also my grandfather by spiritual heart adoption in the 1980s. 1987. This is when my mother and me were lovingly admitted into the life of James and Lottie Martin, his wife, and where a new spiritual journey began for all of us. The following excerpt taken from on October 5th, 1877, the Nez Perce leader Chief Joseph formally surrendered his forces to General Nelson A. Miles. On October 5, 1877, Nez Perce leader Chief Joseph formally surrendered his forces to General Nelson A. Miles and General Oliver Otis Howard at Bear Paw Mountain, Montana Territory. This effectively ended the Nez Perce War of 1877. Previous to the 1877 war, the Army had experienced a history of nonviolent contact with the Nez Perce. In 1804, the Nez Perce resupplied and aided the Army expedition of Captains Meriwether Lewis and William Clark. This aid probably saved the expedition from certain failure. In the 1830s, the Nez Perce also aided in the expedition of Captain Benjamin Bonneville, who took a leave of absence from the Army to proceed with his Western expedition. The hostilities that had been developing during the 1870s between settlers and the Nez Perce turned into violent conflict during mid-June 1877. The first engagement between the Army and the Nez Perce warriors was at White Bird Canyon, Idaho Territory, on June 17. For the Nez Perce, it was a major victory. At White Bird Canyon, they proved to be an effective fighting force. Throughout the summer and early fall of 1877, the fighting skill of the Nez Perce warriors and the military tactics of Nez Perce military leaders, such as Chief Looking Glass and Chief White Bird, enabled the Nez Perce to evade almost certain defeat by superior U.S. Army forces. Nez Perce strength during the 1877 war was estimated to be a few hundred warriors. They had no formal military training and traveled with many non-combatants. The Army, however, would use several thousand soldiers during the 1877 Nez Perce campaign. These were commanded by veterans of the Civil War with years of military training and experience. The Nez Perce and the Army would engage several times as the Nez Perce traveled from their homeland in the Walloa Valley through the Montana and Idaho territories towards their goal of Canada. By October 1877, however, approaching winter weather, lack of supplies, and the effects of traveling more than 1,500 miles over rough western territory had begun to take its toll. The last engagement between The Nez Perce and the Army was fought at Bear Paw Mountain, Montana Territory. This battle took place between September 30 and October 5, 1877. It was after Bear Paw Mountain, when continuing to fight seemed futile, that Chief Joseph surrendered his remaining forces to Miles and Howard. In his surrender speech, Chief Joseph concluded with, "Hear me, my chiefs, I am tired, my heart is sick and sad, and from where the sun now stands, I will fight no more forever." Captains Edward S. Godfrey and Miles Moylan would be awarded the Medal of Honor for their actions against the Nez Perce at Bear Paw Mountain. The Nez Perce were promised by General Miles a safe return to the Walloa Valley. General Miles was overruled and the Nez Perce were instead sent to Kansas and Oklahoma, thus breaking the treaty that was agreed on, where the survivors of 1877 endured many more years of hardship. It was not until the mid-1880s that the Nez Perce were allowed to return to their homelands. Joseph and the other remaining tribal leaders spent their remaining years on the Colville Indian Reservation. The Nez Perce War would not be the last conflict where the decisions and promises of battlefield commanders would be influenced by higher political forces and physically distant command structure, such as elite corporate banksters, different names, different places. But they did commandeer the Civil War genocide. It is no surprise that they would be involved in this war of 1877. About this story, many of the sources presented in this article are quite extensive. In 1804, the Nez Perce resupplied and aided the army expedition of Captain Meriwether Lewis and William Clark. This aid probably saved the expedition from certain failure. In the 1830s, on June 17, and we are just skipping along here, Captains Edward S. Godfrey, How Bear Lost His Tail. Bear once had a long and luxurious tail, like a horse's tail. Bear took good care of his beautiful tail and spent many hours grooming it until it shined brightly like gold. He would brush it out until it glistened in the sun. Bear's tail was his pride and joy, and he couldn't admire it more than he did. He was also very selfish. One day, Grandfather said to his grandson, "It is time for you to go on your vision quest to find your name." Grandfather gave his grandson a stick and some string to take along for his journey into the mountains to find a special name. Grandson went into the mountains and found a frozen lake. He was hungry, so he began to fish from a snow hole he made in the lake. Bear had been guarding his territory and saw the boy on his lake fishing. The boy had already caught two fish and put them on his line. Bear strode up to the boy at his full height of 7 feet, saying, "I am hungry and I am going to eat you up." The boy looked at Bear and said quickly, "Before you eat me, Bear, I would like to teach you how to fish in this fishing hole. Then you'll know how to get fish in the icy lake." Bear stalled and said, "Okay, I'll let you teach me how to fish. Then I'll eat you up." The boy told Bear, "Sit next to the fishing hole with your tail in the water so you can catch the fish. Just swish your tail now and then so the fish will know it's there." Bear swished his tail and caught a fish. Then he caught another fish. When the fish bit Bear on the tail, Bear would swish, quickly swing his tail up out of the water and grab his fish. The boy kept an eye on Bear and watched the ice slowly encompass Bear's tail, trapping it more and more with every minute. He didn't tell Bear to keep swishing the ice so that it wouldn't freeze up around his tail. Then it was too late for Bear to move his tail, even if he wanted to. The boy stood up near Bear and began to tap his stick loudly on the iced over lake. Bear looked at the boy with surprise, saying, "What are you doing? That racket will scare the fish." The boy looked at the bear innocently, saying, "The noise will attract the fish and they will come to see what it is. Then you can catch them." Bear seemed to accept what the boy said and continued to fish with his tail. After a while, the bear didn't move his tail much because the water was very icy cold. The boy cleverly did not tell Bear to keep moving his tail so that it wouldn't freeze in the ice. Bear did not know it, but his tail was beginning to get stuck in the icy lake water. The edges of the fishing hole were freezing up from around the edges of the hole and getting ever closer to Bear's beautiful long tail. It wasn't too long when the boy noticed that the bear's tail was completely frozen into the lake and that he was stuck fast in the fishing hole. The boy got up and began to leave, saying, "Well, Mr. Bear, it was nice knowing you. I have to be going now, and good luck with your fishing." Bear said, "What? Why are you leaving? I haven't eaten you up yet. You can't leave." The boy kept walking on towards the woods. "Bye, Bear. Nice getting to know you. Enjoy your fishing." Then he disappeared into the forest, making his way back to his village. The boy had found his new name, Bear in the Ice. Bear was mad and getting even more mad every second. He tried to lift his tail out of the fishing hole, but he couldn't. He knew that he would freeze to death if he didn't get his tail out of the hole. Bear had to get free of the icy lake. He jerked his body one way and then the other way. Bear went flying up in the air a ways, leaving most of his beautiful long tail in the icy fishing hole that had frozen over. That was the day that Bear lost his beautiful long tail. Bear was disgraced after losing his tail. He saw the tiny stump of a tail remaining on his hind side, and he ran into the woods howling and feeling sorry for his great loss. That is why when you see Bear in the woods, he runs off to be by himself. He is too embarrassed to be caught seen without his gorgeous long tail. Yipsy-yi-yi. How Coyote Got His Song. Every tribe had a link to their stories, including the Bible. All the tribes revered the coyote. Alaska and Canada revered the wolf and raven. These animals were often in their stories because they were around the areas they lived. The Great Spirit made the trees, forests, oceans, lakes, and mountains. Then he made the fish in the water and the birds in the sky. He then went and created all the animals. He made Coyote last and said, "You are going to be the smartest animal and the one who will report to me how the world is coming along." "I am going to make people, and I have to know when the world is ready for them. So report back to me and tell me." The Great Spirit said, "One of these days I am going to make people." The Great Spirit noticed that there wasn't a sound down there on earth, and it was awfully quiet. "One of these days I am going to make people, and I want you to report to me what they are doing. I need to give all the animals songs. The birds and animals were given songs, and since Coyote was the last animal made, he was going to get his song last. Old and patient Coyote didn't want to wait until last to get his song. He wanted it now. Coyote went and found Dove and said, "Dove, give me a song." "Give me a song now," Dove said. "You have to wait for the Great Spirit to give you your song. I can't give you a song." Coyote caught Dove and grabbed him around the neck and shook him harder and harder. Dove howled, "Ow! Owie! Owie!" Coyote stopped squeezing Dove's neck, saying, "That's my song." Coyote sang his new song, and he was so happy he ran off, and while running and singing his new song, he tripped over a log and fell, hitting his head on a tree trunk. Coyote rubbed his head and felt dizzy and sore. He tried and tried to remember his song, but he could not. He went looking for Dove again to find his song. He found Dove and grabbed him, saying, "Mr. Dove, give me back my song. I lost it." He squeezed Dove's neck so hard that he made a bruise mark on Dove's neck that is still on it today. Dove yelled, "Ah, oh, owie, owie!" Coyote released Dove's neck, saying, "That's it. That's my song. I got it back." He was so excited that he ran off and began chasing Wolf, and they played chase in wild circles around each other until Coyote fell and hit his head again on the tree trunk. He sat up and shook his head, saying, "I lost my song. I lost my song. I got to go back and get Dove to give me back my song." He went looking for Dove. Dove knew better this time, and he was not going to let Coyote hurt him. Dove had carved the shape of a dove out of stone and put it on the path. Dove flew high up in the tree and waited for Coyote to come along. He was watching out for Coyote from his high perch in the tree. Coyote came along and saw Dove on the path, and he chomped down hard on the stone dove right around the middle of it. When his teeth clamped down on the stone dove, he let out a howl and kept it up. "I got my song! I got my song back! I got it!" Coyote can now report to the Great Spirit twice a day, once in the morning and once in the evening. The Great Spirit learns all about his daily events on the earth from Coyote. The Truth Stick. The Nez Perce and Rogue River Indians had a truth stick and a lot of beliefs and customs in common with each other. They allowed girls to go on vision quests. The Rogue River people let girls go out on vision quests at the age of 10 to 14 years of age. The Nez Perce allowed girls to go out on vision quests at the age of 8 to 10 years old if the grandparents thought they were ready. The truth stick was like a Bible to the Nez Perce and Rogue River people. The Nez Perce felt that making an oath on a stick was like putting your hand on the Bible, swearing in the truth. It was always decided what was good for the group, and not what was good for just one or a few people. Douglas Fir and the Columbia River. Preface. Douglas Fir and the Columbia River Nez Perce Nimiipuu legends. Coyote is the animal that is symbolic of the Nez Perce, Nimiipuu, because they are called the Coyote people. Coyote is in many of the legends and myths of the Nez Perce, Nimiipuu people because he is smart and lovable. The stories in this edition come from Laurel, who learned stemmed from her grandfather James Martin, a direct grandson of Chief Joseph. Chief Joseph is named Rolling Thunder in the Mountains and is loved and honored for his peaceful ways among his people. How Douglas firs are different from other pine trees and how the Columbia River was formed are the essential elements of discovery in this edition. The Douglas fir has little mice in the pine cones. It's the only cone that has the head tucked way back down under it. The tail and legs of mice. The Great Spirit said he wanted to make people on this earth, and he wanted Coyote to look over the earth and make sure that it was ready. When Coyote got up to the Pacific Northwest, he thought, what a beautiful, beautiful country. The people are going to love this place when they come here. He wandered on to what is now called Montana and found a great, huge lake. This lake ran clear back up into what is now called Canada. History bears this all out, too. This huge lake existed, and there was no Columbia River at this time. Coyote went west to the coast, and he found a big, huge bay, what is now called the Columbia River Bay. The bay was filled with great big fish. The fish were trying to get away into the great big lake to the east in Montana that stretched into Canada. Coyote knew that the people were going to need those fish. He thought how he could get those fish up there, so he started then to dig a trench down to the Columbia River Bay clear up to the lake. Then he turned that lake loose, and it washed down toward the Columbia River Bay, taking out the Columbia River Gorge, making the Columbia River. When Coyote got done digging the trench, he was tired. He crawled up on the side of the mountain and curled up under some big fir trees and went to sleep. The Columbia River is a great river that spans the entire state of Oregon. He fell into a very deep sleep and snored as he slept. A bunch of mischievous mice came and pestered Coyote as he slept. These mice lived in the pine cones of the Douglas fir. Some of the mice got some straws and ran them up his nose. They pulled his eyelids open and pulled on his tail. Coyote opened his eyes and tried grabbing the little mice. All the little mice ran away, and not one was captured by Coyote. He thought he had scared the mice away and returned to his slumber. As soon as Coyote was asleep, the mice returned and snuck up on Coyote again. They teased Coyote, ran straws up his nose, pulled his tail, pulled his ears, and had a wonderful time doing it. Coyote jumped up, and the little mice ran for their lives, disappeared from Coyote's sight once again. He hunted and hunted for the mice. He knew they were there, but he couldn't see them. This time, when Coyote went to sleep, he pretended to be asleep, but he was not. He shut his eyes tightly and snored loudly as he waited for the mice to come to him. He opened up one eye a little bit to peek at the mice as he waited for them to show up. The mice snuck down and started teasing Coyote again. He didn't try to grab the mice. He just watched them. The mice ran up the Douglas fir tree and into the little fir cones. So he reached up quick and grabbed all the fir cones and squeezed them. Coyote spoke to the mice, saying, "Always stay in those little fir cones. When the people come, they will know the Douglas fir because of the little mice in the pine cones." To this day, all the Douglas fir cones have these little mice in them. Sip Sap, the beautiful blue squirrel. Sip Sap was a squirrel of great importance. He was a beautiful blue color, unlike any other squirrel. Sip Sap was very athletic. Squirrels can travel for miles among the treetops without ever touching the ground. Sip Sap was always practicing to run faster and jump further. Jump faster and further. Faster and further. There was never a squirrel like Sip Sap. Sip Sap was special. Sip Sap had been practicing his jumps and leaping skills, and he was very proud of himself. A voice came up to Sip Sap from the forest below. Possum called up to him, "Sip Sap, come down here." Sip Sap heard Possum and came down the tree to speak with him. Possum claimed, "Sip Sap, you are not a squirrel. Squirrels don't run like you, and they don't jump like you. Sip Sap, you are a bluebird. We took a vote, and you are not a squirrel." The deer, bear, squirrels, and other animals had all voted that Sip Sap wasn't a squirrel. The bluebirds heard what Possum had said. Bluebirds sang, "Sip Sap is not one of us. Sip Sap is not a bluebird because he can't fly. Bluebird doesn't have a bushy tail." So they took off Sip Sap's tail. "Bluebird doesn't have climbing feet." So they took off Sip Sap's little climbing feet. "Bluebird doesn't have climbing claws." So they took off Sip Sap's climbing claws. Then they threw Sip Sap up, high up into the tree. All the birds flew away, calling out in the wind, "You are not one of us." Sip Sap didn't have his tail, his climbing feet, or his climbing claws. He had nothing to hold on to when he was high in the tree. Sip Sap didn't have his fluffy tail to slow him down. He didn't have his climbing paws or his climbing claws to grab something when he came down. He couldn't hold onto anything with his new bird claws because he didn't know how to use them. Sip Sap fell straight down. Sip Sap got up off the ground and went off into some bushes where he could be alone. The squirrels would not have him, and the bluebirds would not have him, so he was all alone in the world. He hid in the bush. That is why it is so important for people to accept people just the way they are. Don't try to change others. Appreciate them just as they are. Appreciate their differences. How Raccoon Got His Mask, Preface. Credit for this book goes to my grandfather, James Martin. Most of all, because if he had not shared these stories, I would not be able to share them with the world. Did you ever wonder how Raccoon got his burned mask on his face and down his back and on his ringed tail? Nimiipuu have a perfectly good explanation in this legend myth about to unfold here. Little Coon was the first raccoon, and he was a liar and a thief. Nez Perce Nimiipuu did not believe in mistreatment or other abuse of their tribal members, especially their children. Children were raised to respect themselves and nature, along with responsibility to their families, tribe, and nature. How Raccoon Got His Mask. A long, long time ago, in the beginning, there lived a grandma who lived with her grandson named Little Coon. They lived in a beautiful village where the gentle pines blew and soft winds sang through the needles like ever gentle instruments of God. Grandmother was a very busy and industrious and wise. She worked hard every day, though through the day and often into the night. She had a grandson named Little Coon. One day Grandmother said, "Little Coon, help me gather acorns. We need to gather them now, while they are plentiful." Little Coon was a rascal. He did not want to work. He wanted to do other things more exciting to him, like all little boys and girls. He wanted to go swimming and enjoy the Indian summer. Grandma said, "No, you can't go swimming. You must help me gather the acorns now in the autumn, because soon winter will be here. We must have food this winter." Little Coon was a lazy little fellow. He said, "Grandma, let's wait for all the acorns to fall and collect them then." Grandma said, "No, Little Coon, we must gather them now, because if we wait for all the acorns to fall and gather them then, the other animals will get them and eat them too." Grandma and Little Coon picked up lots of acorns they found on the ground. They used the switch to shake more acorns off the trees and as high as they could reach. Then Grandma took the acorns and put them into a hole she had carefully lined with leaves. Then she covered the acorns with more leaves to keep them stored well until they were needed. This was called catching the nuts for the winter. Little Coon asked, "Grandma, can I go swimming now since we are done?" Grandma told him, "Little Coon, you can go swimming after you gather the acorns from the tree over there. First, let's go to the teepee so I can prepare our meal." She began to prepare the meal for them to eat. She put hot round rocks into the fire pit to heat up the cooking area. She used long willow switches that formed into what looks like tennis rackets. These paddles were used to move the hot rocks to a cool water reservoir. Little Coon was not happy. He began to badmouth Grandma, thinking to himself, "That mean old woman, she makes me work. She won't let me eat. She won't let me go swimming." He was feeling very bad for himself. He was wandering around and found a catch of acorns and ate them. Then he found more holes filled with nuts and ate them all too. Before he knew it, the whole catch of acorns was gone. Little Coon wondered what he could do so Grandma wouldn't find out what he had done. He decided to fill the acorn catches with little rocks to hide what he had done from her. Little Coon was so full his tummy was bulging. He went into his teepee and went to the back, where he curled up into a ball and fell asleep. Grandma was looking for acorns in the catch and couldn't find any acorns, just empty holes and ones filled with rocks. Grandma rushed into the teepee and asked Little Coon, "What did you do with those acorns, Little Coon? Where are they?" Little Coon said, "I didn't have them. I don't know where they are." Grandma asked Little Coon three times where the acorns had gone, and each time Little Coon denied any wrongdoing about the nuts. Little Coon said, "For the third time, Grandma, I don't know what happened to those nuts." Grandma was so mad she grabbed the cooking paddle and swung wide with it toward Little Coon. She caught Little Coon across his face, burning the little mask on his face. Then Little Coon tried to evade Grandma, and he made a run right underneath the paddle, which burned his backside. And Little Coon was almost away from Grandma, but not before his tail got singed with rings from her cooking stone paddle. Great Spirit told Little Coon, "You lied, you stole, and now you will wear your mask, burned back marks, and ringed tail forever, more to show the world how naughty you were." Biography, Laurel Marie Sobol. Laurel has dedicated her life to making the world a better place and has chosen the gifts God has given her, me, to share with the world. The love of God, family, and God's creation have been uppermost in her thoughts for decades. Indeed, she creates every painting and work of literature with the same passion-filled spirit of one someone would expect who walks close with the Lord. This is Laurel's story. It is that simple. Laurel paints with whirling, vibrant, changing rainbows of color on her canvas and through her words in books and stories. She brings all of her artistic knowledge base and excellence into each and every single piece, be it a painting or a book, and she flies with the wind of the Lord, guiding her path. Laurel has studied the most famous artists of all time and is appropriately thankful for those who have come forth and said to her that your paintings look like a Van Gogh or Monet. Laurel appreciates what these critics see about her art. Laurel takes no shortcuts in to minimalize any painting or book she's written. These are the things that separate Laurel from some other artists. Though Laurel hopes many artists who already do share many of the elements she incorporates in her arts will be increasingly generated in other artists globally. Laurel recognizes that art talks is a very real universal language touching hearts and souls of creation worldwide. Art talks is art primarily painted or written art forms that inspire people to love God, Mother Earth, God's creation, and humanity, bringing all to the table to talk about peace and love among mankind for one another and the earth. A peaceful, loving world can't refuse to care for the earth and its wellness, productivity, sustainability, and leaving much of world's glorious and wonderful places in their natural beauty, beautiful way, always. Laurel Marie Sobol. How Coyote Got His Song, Yipsy Yay Yay.
How Coyote Got His Song, Yipsy Yay Yay.
Every tribe had a link to their stories, including the
Every
Bible.
Every tribe had a
All
link
the tribes
to their stories,
revered the coyote.
The Bible.
Alaska
the
and Canada revered the,
wolf.
Alaska
and
Raven.
Revered the
These
wolf.
Animals were often in their
and
stories
Raven.
Because they were around
These
the areas they lived.
Often in their stories because
the
they
Great
were
Spirit
around
made
the
trees,
they lived.
Forests,
the Great Spirit
oceans,
made the trees,
lakes, and
forests,
mountains. Then
oceans,
he made the fish
lakes,
in the water
and
the birds in
then
the sky.
He, made the fish in the
he
water,
then went and created all the animals.
Sky.
He made Coyote last
and
said, you are going to be the smartest animal and the one who will report to me how the world is coming along. I am going to make people and I have to know when the world is ready for them. So report back to me and tell me, the Great Spirit said, one of these days I am going to make people.
One of these days, I am going to make people.
The Great Spirit noticed that there wasn't a sound down
the
there
Great
on
Spirit
earth,
noticed that there
and
wasn't
it was awfully
a
quiet.
Sound down there on earth, and it
One
was
of these days,
quiet.
I'm going to make people, and I want you
One
to report
days,
to me what
to
they are doing.
People, and I, want
I need to give
to
all the animals
what they are
songs.
Doing.
The
I
birds
need to give
and
all
animals
the animals
were.
Songs. Birds,
given songs, and since Coyote was the last
songs,
animal made, he was going to get his song
last.
Old impatient Coyote didn't want to wait until last to get his song. He wanted it now. Coyote went and found Dove and said, Dove, give me a song. Give me a song now.
Give me a
Dove said,
give me a song
you have
now.
To wait for the
Dove
Great Spirit
said,
to give you your song.
You have to wait
I can't
for
give,
the
you
Great Spirit to give you a song.
Coyote caught Dove and grabbed
song.
Him around the neck and shook
Coyote
him harder and harder.
And
Dove howled,
owie!
Coyote stopped squeezing Dove's neck, saying, That's it.
Coyote stopped
That's my new song.
Dove's neck, saying,
Coyote sang
That's
his
it.
New song.
That's my new
and
song.
He was so happy.
Coyote
he ran
sang
off
his new
and
song.
While running and singing
he was so
his
happy.
New song,
he, ran off
he tripped
and
over
while running and singing
a log
his new
and
song,
fell,
he tripped
hitting
over
his head on
a
tree
log
trunk.
And fell,
Coyote rubbed his head and felt dizzy
trunk.
And sore.
Coyote rubbed his head.
He tried and tried to remember his song, but he could not.
He tried.
He went looking for Dove again to find his song.
He went looking for Dove again to find his song.
He found Dove and grabbed him, saying, "Mr. Dove, give me back my song. I lost it."
He squeezed Dove's neck. "Give me back my song. I lost it."
So hard that he made a bruise mark on Dove's neck that is still on it today.
Dove yelled. That is still on it today.
Ow! Dove yelled. Eee!
Coyote
released Dove's neck, saying, "That's it. That's my song. I got it back."
That's it.
He was so excited that he ran off and began chasing Wolf. And they played chase in wild circles around each other until Coyote fell and hit his head again on the tree trunk.
He
sat up and shook his head, saying, "I lost my song. I lost my song. I got to go back and get Dove to give me my song back." He went looking for Dove. Dove knew better this time, and he was not going to let Coyote hurt him again. Dove had carved the shape of a dove out of stone and put it on the path. Dove flew high up in a tree and waited for Coyote to come along. He was watching out for Coyote from his high perch in the tree. Coyote came along and saw Dove on the path. And he chomped down hard on the stone dove right around the middle of it.
When his teeth clamped
down on the stone dove, he let out a howl and kept it up. "I got my song back! I got my song back! I got it!" Coyote ran. Coyote can now report to the Great Spirit twice a day. Once in the morning and once in the evening. The Great Spirit learns all about the daily events on the earth from Coyote.